have some announcements for you today. If most of you can't tell, it is raining out this morning. So when it rains for our outdoor services, this is what we will be doing, is a live broadcast from inside the church. So if you are on your way to church, feel free to turn around, go home, and catch us on Facebook. That's where we will be live streaming for now. Other announcements, we do have a tech meeting this Wednesday at 7 o'clock. That will be via Zoom. I want to let you all know that sometime this week we are going to be implementing our new website. So the tech team has been working on our website for quite some time now. It should be ready to go live this week. I'm letting you know because it may take a day or two for it to transfer. So if you're trying to check our website and you see that it's not there, just know that the new site will be up in about a day. So that's pretty exciting. The last thing I want to let you all know is if any of the chair people for any committees, I went ahead and donated a Zion Zoom account so that we can keep in touch. So if anybody needs to use that for any meetings related to the church, just feel free to let me know, and then we can do that. All right, thank you.
Good morning. The Old Testament reading today is from the book of Genesis, chapter 32, verses 22 to 31. The same night he rose and took his two wives, his two maids, and his 11 children, and crossed the ford of Jabbok. He took them and sent them across the stream, and likewise everything that he had. And Jacob was left alone, and a man wrestled with him until the breaking of the day. And the man saw that he did not prevail against Jacob. He touched the hollow of his thigh, and Jacob's thigh was put out of joint as he wrestled with him. And then he said, "Let me go. The day is breaking." But Jacob said, "I will not let you go unless you bless me." And he said to him, "What is your name?" And he said, "Jacob." And then he said, "Your name shall no more be called Jacob, but Israel, for you have striven with God and with me and have prevailed." Then Jacob asked him, "Tell me, I pray, your name." But he said, "Why is it you ask my name?" And there he blessed him. So Jacob called the name on the place Peniel, saying, "For I have seen God face to face, and yet my life is preserved." The sun rose upon him as he passed Peniel, limping because of his thigh. Therefore, to this day, the Israelites do not eat the sinew of the hip, which is upon the hollow of the thigh, because he touched the hollow of Jacob's thigh and the sinew of the hip.
Stepped in the pulpit pull together as a nation, as a church, and as a people. For we pray in the name of your Son and our Savior, Jesus Christ, who lives and reigns with you, Father, and the Holy Spirit, one God, now and forever.
With us here again this week on USA for Monday Night Raw, Macho Man Randy Savage. Look who's coming to the ring.
One of the things that came up in my mind was my boyhood love of wrestling. Love wrestling. And indulge me here just for a minute. Why is she going to indulge me here for a minute? Anyways, love wrestling as a kid. Hulk Hogan. Hulk Hogan and Andre the Giant, Gorilla Monsoon, Bobby the Brain Heenan. All these people from WWF. Yes, I'll get to the WCW in a minute, and the WWE, let alone the NWA. All these people that I remember from my childhood. The Iron Sheik, Randy Macho Man Savage, Steamboat, Goldust, who was Dusty Rhodes' kid. Goldust wrestled, I think it was, in the WWF, but Dusty did most of his wrestling in the WWE. Vince McMahon, I know he wasn't really as much of a wrestler, but he was a promoter and he started out with the WWF. Originally it was the Northeast Territory, the northeastern part of the country, so we knew them very, very well. The Dingo Warrior, who was this guy who later became the Ultimate Warrior, he wore this paint on his face, and he was supposedly from Queens, New York, this big, rough, crippling kind of guy, but actually he was from Crawfordsville, Indiana, a little town northwest of Indianapolis. Now, I love the WWF, but WWE was really my preference. Not to belabor the point this morning, but I remember watching as a boy people like Tully Blanchard and Arn and Ole Anderson. And of course, this guy who had bleached blonde hair would come out wearing a boa and a woman's nightgown, and he'd come walking out with his sunglasses. Nobody else would. Makes your boy Ric Flair. I'm not going to do his sounds this morning. You at home probably remember, at least I know a couple people who are old enough to remember. Nature Boy, Ric Flair. Not to mention the Fabulous Freebirds when they took back the title in 1984 in the WWE. Now I'm dating myself with some of our tech folks here this morning. Okay, I guess I like the wrestling. Wrestling, as some of my friends used to call it. I could go on, but I won't, for the sake of this broadcast here this morning. Love wrestling. Thought it was fantastic. People used to say, they don't say so much anymore because it's not as popular as COVID. Used to say back in that day when I was a teenager, when I was a boy, you know, it's all fake. It's all phony. You know, it's not really a sport. It's not really a contest. But I don't know, there's something about 325 pound guys, many of them got all muscled up and everything, who can throw each other around, fake or not, and not get hurt. There's some athleticism involved there, even if it isn't entirely on the up and up. But you know, wrestling in a way, you might not think of it this way, but wrestling, the story that they tell, with all the drama and the audience and the costumes and all the absurdity, wrestling really is about good and evil. It's about honor and perseverance. And it does communicate through its dramatic absurdity, at least classical wrestling. Wrestling does communicate the importance of value and honor and truth telling. With the good guys and the bad guys. It might be a little absurd to you, it might seem a little ridiculous, but there's something about it. Wrestling in many ways is like the American version of Japanese kabuki theater. With all of it, it sounds outlandish to you, perhaps your Facebook world, but it is kind of like Japanese kabuki theater with its opulent dress and some of its absurdities. It's communicating a greater point. It's like that kind of theater. In many of the same ways, it's kind of like, you know, country and Western music is sort of the American version of opera. Now that might seem ridiculous to you too, but if you think about it, in country and Western music, much like an opera, somebody's cheating on somebody, and somebody's going to wind up dead as a jilted lover. That's true in country and Western, it's also true in opera. So all this kind of family dysfunction going on. All you have to do for opera is add up some pickup trucks and you've got country and Western music. It's really the same kind of thing. It might seem a bit much we can say here or hear this morning, but it's really a similar kind of thing. Jacob wrestles and becomes Israel. Jacob sends his two wives and their two maids, the four women with whom he has children that we know of. He sends these four women and his 11 children, all of his livestock, all of his possessions. He sends them across the Jabbok, sends them across the river. And he goes and camps on the other side of the river, a place that he's going to wind will not let that messenger go. He will not let him go until he blesses him. And of course, at the end of the story, the angel will bless him by smacking him on the hip socket. I don't know, I get smacked on the hip socket, I get a little bit of arthritis on there or something like that. But Jacob pulls on for his blessing. Jacob persists and he perseveres. He goes forward. He is one who has what we call stick-to-itiveness. He will not let go until he is blessed. He will not relent until he receives the blessing of God. He cannot earn the blessing of God any more than you or I can. He cannot demand the grace of God any more than you can or I can. But he will be in the moment. He will persist and he will persevere until he receives God's blessing. He sticks to it in the present moment and he goes forward. Come what may, he sticks to it and he goes forward. And as he walks with God, he doesn't give up. He persists. And there's something here this morning for us that we must persist in our life, regardless of who we are or where we are or our present circumstances. And certainly in this age of COVID, many people are feeling not only the angst that is throughout the world because of the virus, but people are feeling personal angst because of situations at work, with their family, and all the unknowns that are going on right now. There's all this great deal of anxiety to varying degrees of people. Even with people who are denying the reality of the situation, there's still anxiety. We all feel it, yes? We all know it. But Jacob is one who, in the midst of the difficulty, will not give up. He persists and he perseveres until he receives the blessing of God. We hear this story which Marge read from the 14th chapter of St. Matthew in the Gospel. And this is the feeding of 5,000 story. Jesus with his disciples and this weary group of people who've been following him around. People who are exhausted. People who don't know where to turn. They don't know where they're going to get their next meal, let alone the other situations and problems that they're facing in their families and in their villages. They are exhausted, mentally exhausted, physically exhausted, emotionally exhausted. They've been following Jesus around and his disciples. And the disciples they themselves are exhausted. The disciples have compassion fatigue. And so they say to Jesus as the afternoon is wearing on, they say, Jesus, well, send the people away. Send them away. Let them go into the town to get some dinner or something else. We can't provide for them. We only have 5 loaves and 2 fish. We don't have enough. We don't have enough for ourselves. But send them away. Prior, right to the story, Jesus had heard that his beloved cousin, John the Baptist, had been executed. And so Jesus, you can imagine what Jesus is going through, emotional exhaustion on his own, psychological exhaustion, a great deal of grief on his own. His cousin John has been executed for standing up for what is true, for standing up to Pharaoh and the empire, for standing up for what is right and just, for standing up for God's way of love and compassion and justice. His cousin, standing up for what was right, and he was executed. So Jesus is feeling this grief and this emotional exhaustion. He went to get away. And the crowds followed him, and his disciples don't know what to do. And Jesus has to manage all of these things. You know, it must be like many ways, you know, a mother at home taking care of her children, and maybe taking care of her husband, and taking care of this and that, and demanding again and again and again, what can you do for me, mom? Feeling this kind of exhaustion. Going, trying. word is the way to persist and to persevere in the present moment. In that word is the way forward now and for all time. So we are called to strive. We are called to strive, day in and day out. We are called to struggle, to face what life is. We are called to strive, we are called to struggle, we are called to face the world in real time as it is, with all of its problems and all of its difficulties. We are called to face these challenges, but we are also called to persist in the face of uncertainty, to persist in the face of difficulty, in the face of hatred. We are called to persist in the face of things that are not pleasant, and we are also called to persevere in the presence of these things, to persist and to persevere as we face life, but also we are called to, for a season, take time away. Jesus, when he faced difficulty great grief and sorrow, he always took time to be away in prayer, to re-energize. But in that time, as God, he joined reality as it was, so he could persist and to persevere, to face things. Facing things with the grace of God being our strength. We are called to strive, we are called to struggle in this life, and we are called to wrestle. And in the striving, and in the struggling, and in the wrestling, know that Jesus is with us. In the striving, and in the struggling, know that God is with you as you face difficult times in your life, as you face uncertain times in your life, whether it's an uncertain time with your family or friends, an uncertain time at work, an uncertain time in the nation or in the world. When you face difficult times and troubling times, there's time to set yourself apart in prayer, there's time to seek refreshment, and there's time again to persist and to persevere and to face what you must face. But you face it with the power of God, and you face it with the strength of Christ, yes? The power of God and the strength of Christ. And in that wrestling, when we wrestle with Jesus, what do we come back with? When we wrestle with Jesus, what do we come back with but compassion? When we wrestle with Jesus, what do we find? But compassion and responsibility. When we wrestle with Christ and draw from that well, what do we find? Strength for our souls. When we wrestle with Jesus, we find compassion and responsibility, and we live in and with and through grace. We live for God, and we live for one another. In other words, do your best with what you have today. Some days your best is up here. Some days your best is way down here. You get that on camera? Way down here, some days it's up here. That's fine. You're a human being. You're a human being. I'm a human being. That's the way it is. The disciples were fatigued with compassion this morning. But we must persist. We must persist in this present hour. Even in this face of uncertainty, we must persist. And we must persevere as best as we can. Persist and persevere. And in the struggle and in the strain, in the struggle and in the strain, we will discover grace. In the struggle and the strain, God will lift us up so we can persist and persevere more. Jacob would, in turn, after he wrestled with the angel, Jacob would bless his family, and he would bless his kin, his wives, his maids, his children, and so forth. Jesus had compassion for the crowd, and in doing so, he taught the disciples to take what they had, to do the best of what they had, and to share that compassion, to be compassionate toward others. So Jesus teaches us that as well. But take the simple gifts that we have and use them to bless others. But in all of it, what we learn is to persist and to persevere. And sometimes persistence, sometimes resting with God just teaches us that we've got to put one foot in front of the other. Some days it's like that, isn't it? You just got to get up, get out of bed, wash your face, put on your lipstick, comb your hair, put one foot in front of the other, and get going about your day. Do the best you can with what you have. Persist. Persist and persevere. Put one foot in front of the other. Love your God and love your neighbor and follow Jesus as best as you can. Know that he goes with you. And things not only are going to be just all right, things will be good. Things will be good. Things will change. And there is hope today Now, friends, we come to a time where we're going to be sharing joys and concerns. I know some of you shared some things online. Please know that what you're sharing online, we're lifting up as a community here and throughout the world. We're worshiping community and praise together as we serve together. And so we're going to be sharing those things in a moment. Those will be coming up in prayer. And I'm going to invite you at this time, if you're at home, or you're watching on your laptop, or your iPad, or watching on your phone, that if you would, join us in spirit of prayer. Let us pray. Lord Christ, we give you thanks for the example of our ancestor in the faith, Jacob, and how he persisted and persevered, and how he held on for his blessing, and he took his blessing to bless others. And we thank you for the example of your Son, our Savior Jesus, who teaches us that it's okay to take time away to be in prayer. It's okay because we are human and we need to get away for a time. We are human, and the difficulties and tragedies of this life sometimes are overwhelming, sometimes are exhausting. For those who are overwhelmed this morning, we pray and lift them up. And for those who are mentally or emotionally exhausted, we ask that we lift them up this morning, but we also pray that they would cast their cares upon you. Because we know that in our exhaustion, we know that in our struggles, we know that in our difficulties, that we are called to cast all of our cares upon you. Us rest. And so this morning also we pray for Vicki, and we pray for Vicki's mom. We pray for healing for them, and we pray for healing for Nancy. We pray this morning for all who are in hospital, and the doctors and nurses and medical professionals caring for them. We pray for all who have been stricken with COVID, and for those who are struggling with this horrible disease. We thank you for the doctors and nurses caring for them. We pray for the scientists who are trying to find a vaccine and other mitigation for this terrible disease. We thank you for their knowledge and their wisdom and their hard work, and we lift them up this morning. We pray this morning for our President Donald, and we pray for our Congress. We pray this morning for our Governor Gretchen, and we pray for those serving in Lansing. We pray for all of our public safety officers, for our police officers and our firefighters. We pray for all those who are in active service for our country. We pray for people who are overcome with fear and anxiety and live above this morning. We pray for people who are protesting and marching for a more peaceable country, a more equitable country. And we pray that in our civil descent, since our nation is founded upon civil descent, that we would dissent in a way that also is peaceful. That is the hallmark and the bedrock of our country, to express our opinions and to share our beliefs, but to do it in a peaceful and civilized way. We pray for those, Lord, who are struggling with finances this morning, those who are struggling with drug addiction. We pray for those who are struggling with alcohol addiction, and we lift them up this morning, that they would find a path to sobriety. Lord Jesus, for those who are struggling in any way this morning, may they know the power of your love and the strength of your grace. May they seek to persist in this hour and to persevere. And may they find their persistence and their perseverance. May they find strength, which comes only from you, the great well. May they know the strength of your love and the power of your word. May they know the strength of your love in the sacrament that we are about to share. If you are home this morning, as I'm praying and speaking with God, if you are home, you have a piece of bread, you have a glass of wine, some juice, we invite you now to get those things and bring them to your dining room table or to your living room, and we can share the sacrament together. But Lord Jesus, we give you thanks for your love. We give you thanks for your presence. For you are in the midst. You are in the midst of our struggle. You are in the midst of our wrestling. You are in the midst of our joys and our sorrows. And you never abandon us, and you only uphold us. And so we thank you for your great love and the power of your grace. Thank you for all these things, O Lord, and we pray your blessing upon your people, even as we now pray the prayer you taught us to say together. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our debts, as we forgive our debtors. And lead us not into temptation, but virtually and at your kitchen tables throughout the world in the sacrament of Holy Communion, the sacrament of our redemption. And we always know that we are called to persist and to persevere in faith, and that you are with us, that God is with you. God is with you through the power of his love, through the power of his grace, the word spoken and preached, hopefully, and here in the sacrament, the simple gifts of bread and wine, we are fed spiritually. And so also know that we all are welcome here at Christ's table, all are welcome here at Christ's altar. It is his table and his altar, and we are all welcome regardless of our background, regardless of our tradition. We are all welcome to receive from this table, from this altar, to receive the grace and love of God, which is for all people. For all people now and forevermore. Amen. And now as we come into the time of offering, we offer this whole worship up to God, because worship is to what we offer to God. God doesn't need our offering, but he receives our offering as a sign of our gratitude. And so we offer this worship up to God. I remind you that it says in the good book, the Lord loves a cheerful giver. A cheerful giver loves the Lord. Amen. The Lord be with you. We remember, on the night in which he was betrayed, the Lord Jesus took bread, and giving thanks, he blessed it, and broke it, and gave it to his disciples, saying to them, "This is my body, which is broken for you, and for all people, for the forgiveness of your sin. As often as you eat this bread, do this in memory of me." We remember that when the supper ended, the Lord Jesus took cup, and giving thanks, he blessed it, and gave it to his disciples, saying to them, "This is my blood of the new and everlasting covenant, which is shed for you and for all people for the forgiveness of your sin. As often as you drink from this cup, do this in memory of me." Wherefore, O Father, we, your humble servants, keep this perpetual memorial, the sacrifice your Son and our Savior, Jesus Christ, made once and for all, the full and complete remission of our sins and the sins of the entire world, the sacrifice which you willingly made upon Calvary, upon the cross upon Calvary. And we ask you, O Lord, now to send your Holy Spirit over these gifts of bread and wine, that they may be for us your people here among Clements and throughout the world, that they may be for us your people the most precious body and blood of your Son and our Savior Jesus Christ. Send your Holy Spirit over these gifts of bread and wine, that we may receive in this sacrament this very, very gift of your Son. We ask for this, O Lord, in the name of your Son, our Savior, Jesus Christ, who lives and reigns with you in the Holy Spirit, one God, now and forevermore. Amen. Christ, our Passover, was sacrificed for us. Therefore, let us keep the peace. So we thank you for your great love, which we receive here in this sacrament. And we ask your blessing upon our congregation, upon your congregation, and upon all of your churches of all denominations, and all of your people of every faith and of no particular faith, that you would bless them and watch over them, and that they would, through your great love, they We ask all this in the name of your Son and our Savior, Jesus Christ, who lives and reigns with you, Father, and the Holy Spirit, one God, now and always. Amen.
May